Come on, do it again. Do it again. This isn't funny. Please, come on. Cindy, it's for you. Welcome back to Plastic TV, you guys. Woo! Another round of this shit. So, today, if you haven't noticed, we're gonna be discussing Scream. So this past weekend, I've had the pleasure of going to see Scream 2022, which is also Scream 5, because I don't know why they just won't call it Scream 5, because that's what it is. It's a continuation of the story that we've all been hearing since 1996, since the first Scream, which I'm going to get into in a minute. But first, I know what time it is. I got to do a lip check, because what? No dry lips. Not on my set. And if you guys watched the last two videos, I'm using Candy Apple from Bath & Body Works. Okay, now that I've gotten that out of the way, let me get this disclaimer out. So, yeah, if you haven't seen the movie, I'm about to like kind of tell, you know, spoil it a little bit. So, you know, if you just really don't give a damn, keep watching. But if you really do, then I suggest you just wait until you see the movie to watch this video, because I'm about to go in, okay? So overall, the whole movie was pretty much good as hell. Like, it succeeded its predecessors from before. Okay, I take that back. Scream 2, it was my favorite one. Scream 2, I don't know, it's just something about Scream 2. But this Scream was awesome. Like, it was nostalgic. It had all the legacy characters, Nev Campbell, Courtney Cox, and David Arquette. R.I.P. yeah. So the first scene, which is the first kill scene, I kind of like how they connected Tara, who was played by Jenna Ortega, character, to Drew Barrymore's character in the first movie, Casey Becker. I know this is my favorite shirt now. They kind of point out some key elements. They have similarities, like in the first Scream, where Drew Barrymore pretty much takes out the knife and the little knife thingy in the kitchen. Tara does the same thing. And also, she's also quizzed on stab movies like Drew Barrymore, but instead of stab movies, Drew Barrymore was quizzed on past horror movies like Halloween, Friday the 13th, etc., etc. Shockingly, Tara survives all of this. This is like the first kill scene in the whole entire Scream franchise where the killer does not kill the first victim. Like, my mind was blown, because she faced a lot of injuries. Like, this bitch, pretty much everybody in this movie, like, if you didn't die, like, if you got stabbed or shot or something, they walked around like nothing happened. Like, they were, oh yeah, girl, I got shot, but yeah, girl, what you doing today? Like, you know, it's crazy. So she survived the attacks, and all of her friends come to the hospital to see her. And her big sister, Sam Carpenter, who's played by Melissa Barrera, I hope I pronounced that right, and her boyfriend Richie also, who's played by Jack Quaid, also comes, and she's pretty much in distress. She's like, what's going on? Why were you attacked? And Sam has a family secret, and she thinks that's why she was attacked. But here's the screamer. Are you ready? Are you ready for this? Sam is the daughter of Scream's original franchise, Scream's original movie, Billy Loomis. I know, right? I was like, oh. So this kind of put a rift between Sam and Tara, because Tara was just like, you've been gone for 5 years and you just now coming back. And then you want to tell me this stuff? Like, she told her, she was like, get the fuck out. Like, I know that's right, because girl, why did you... But we learned that Dewey and Gail are no longer together, because if you remember in Scream 3, He proposed to her in Scream 4. They were married. Now they're divorced and separated because Gail apparently wanted to go to Hollywood and Dewey didn't want that kind of lifestyle. So they end up splitting ways and he ended up becoming a drunk and he lives in a trailer park. It was, you know, the man is down bad. I was like, damn, Dewey, I'm so sorry.
It was so nice to see a tribute to Randy Meeks, who was played by Jamie Kennedy in the first and second Scream,
because he ended up dying in the second Scream because Billy's mother murdered him in that van. Matter of fact, let's roll the clip.
Randy spoke poorly of Billy, and I got a little knife happy.
Yeah, bitch was wounded. Anyway, so fast forward, Sydney comes home, sees Gail in the hospital, and she tries to give Sam some advice. She tries to get her some help. And I kind of like this part because Sam was just like, you know, my dad is Billy Loomis, you know, are you, you know, freaked out about that? She was like, no, like, bitch, I killed him. Like, why am I freaked out about that? Like, I killed this motherfucking ass. I got my revenge. I mean, he cheated on me. I got my revenge. He's dead.
After a disagreement with Sydney and Gail,
Sydney did the Gail Weathers thing and put a tracker on Sam's car. So Sam and Richie and Tara are in the car and they're on their way out of Woodsboro, but Tara decided that she wants to lose her inhaler. And so they have to go back to Amber, who is her best friend's house, and get her extra inhaler. Now, this next part is what I was like, whoa. So
it turns out that Amber's house is in the middle of nowhere, but not only is it in the middle of nowhere,
it is Stu Mocker's house, which was the original setting of the first Scream movie, where the third act final bloodbath scene, the final showdown, where all of that took place. Amber is staying in that house now. And not only that, so this bitch is throwing apart
the house and they hear screaming coming out and it's Amber's ass coming out there doing all that damn screaming, that fake ass screaming.
And Sydney and Gail were just like, girl, do you believe that? And Gail was just like, girl, no. And so Amber, it was just like, yeah, bitch, pow, pow. Once again, Gail gets shot in her stomach. She got shot in the same place as Scream 2. Like, she didn't get shot in Scream 3. And she got stabbed in Scream 4. But she got shot in the stomach in Scream 2. And Sydney goes in the house. And, of course, she's shooting up everything because she's been here, done this shit before. Like, she's...
And so Ghostface calls Sydney and was just like, hey, Sydney, welcome back.
She was just like, I've seen this movie before. Like, I've been here, done this. Can we just get this over with so I can go home to my kids? Like, I don't have time for this shit. So Ghostface is just like, it's two killers. And so she starts shooting up every damn thing. And she shoots into a closet where Richie is hiding. And he's like, no, shoot me. And she's like, get the fuck out of the closet right now. And so that's when Ghostface comes out and starts attacking her. And it's a gun on the floor. So Sam, who found Tara tied up in the closet because Richie told her that she was the killer, Sam comes out and she attacks Ghostface, but Richie is helping her get down the stairs, and what do you know, he stabs Sam, and this motherfucker is the second killer. Wow, the boyfriend. So they all end up in the kitchen like the first movie, Sam and Sydney, and God, they kind of do like a mirror of Billy and Stu singing with them in the kitchen, except it's like the new girl and the old girl. And they do this whole, you know, motive thing of they were super fans and Stab 8 needed some new material. The directors and writers needed new material. So they decided to take it upon themselves to have fresh and new based on true story motives. Material. When I saw that, she was dumb because it was just like, you did all these just for fresh source material. Like, you could have just gave them fresh source material. Like, you could have wrote it yourself, but you know, what do I know? I don't know anything.
And so we get to Richie and Sam. They're fighting or whatever, and he's choking the shit out of Sam. But Sam sees her dead father, which is Billy Loomis, who's played by Skeet Ulrich, by the way. He sees her in the mirror and he's like, bitch, a knife is right there. Like, get the knife and stab his ass. So she gets the knife and is just like just doing his shit in. He was just like, what about my ending? And she was like, here you go. and she slit his throat. And so that's when Sydney and Gail come back in the front room, and that was just like, all right, you know, one of them about to come back alive. And so Sam was just like, not in my movie. Pow, pow, pow. And shot Richie ass the fuck up. And here go Amber, burnt ass. Ah! And so Tara ended up shooting her ass in the head. So I was like, oh, gosh. Like, bitch, you were just burnt alive. Like, I didn't, she had no issues either.
So I gave this movie a 10 out of 10
because it was everything I needed. It was nostalgic. It was good to see characters growing up. It was good to see new characters. It was refreshing to not focus on Sydney, but more so tell a new story because this is a new generation. Like, I'm so glad they did not carry on with this whole Maureen Prescott, which is Sydney's mother, storyline, because it's dried out and gone. Like, who else could be the killer? Like, her grandma, her uncle, like all her family is dead. So she really doesn't have anybody to kill her.
But, you know, I really enjoyed this movie. I love Scream so much. It's my favorite franchise. And before I go, make sure you guys subscribe to my channel. I mean, like, comment, and subscribe. But make sure you subscribe and tell your friends, because if you don't, I'm going to become Ghostface and I'm going to go after you. Okay? So, bye. Scare you later.
I want to be in the sequel. Because I see you trying. Subliminally trying to see it.